Thank you. I'm sorry not having longer, but we are running of time, and sorry that we will end a little bit later, but we have our last and not least speaker, Mr. Lior Tabansky, who is a senior researcher at the Yuval Ne'eman Workshop for Science Technological Security. He is a PhD candidate in Political Science Department. Mr. Tabansky, his research interests include comparative national cybersecurity policy, military innovation, and ICT in counterterrorism. Lior, please.
The recently amended theory of human needs is famous. But Abraham Maslow also developed a concept known in psychology as the law of the instrument. In summer 2010, I attended one of the first conferences on cyber. We enjoyed great talks on technological products and the evolution of malware and solutions. And then one of the speakers said that technology, cybersecurity is not about technology, which is quite real, right? But except this speaker, was a highly esteemed IT security leader making his living from selling products. This is how I learned that people can break through this law of the instrument, Maslow's hammer. I try to follow the same path. Today, I present the military innovation framework from the security studies, outline its record, and potential benefit to strategic cybersecurity using a couple of examples. I am Lior Tabansky, political scientist by training and a computer guy by craft. My doctoral thesis hopefully will bring security studies up to date with the current developments. I'm a member of a diverse team here at Tel Aviv University. We tackle complex security technologically relevant challenges to security. Now, jumping straight in. We are well aware of the situation. Every industrial and business process have been computerized, which brings us great prosperity, but also brings cyber risks into the physical world. Not talking about information, this is physical damage possible. So this is a situation. I think you will all agree with me. All sorts of these breaches, some of them are foreign attacks. Some of them are destructive attacks, what my colleague Ram Levy here calls denial of computing, such as the case with Saudi Aramco and the South Korean case. So this is what we see. IT security is there, but the net result, as we see from the turnout of this conference, that the problem is growing and security is decreasing. This is how we see it in general common sense. I want to bring it into another prism. I want to look at it from a national security context. Foreign attacks on civilian targets are rising. Some of them are destructive. A destructive cyber attack on critical infrastructure is a new way to achieve a very important military goal in any conflict. Such an attack renders traditional border defense obsolete. Such an attack it also renders deterrence problematic because of the attribution problem. So what we see here is not less IT security. We see that traditional defense is being rendered obsolete. This is what's new in cyber, but it's not new in security studies. Technology has always driven strategic change. The latest wave of the so-called revolution in military affairs was the information technology revolution in military affairs, the application of computers to security issues. It was spectacularly demonstrated since the 91 Gulf War. Sorry, that's back. My previous research outlined the crucial importance of these capabilities in the Israeli attempt to counter suicide terrorism in the early 2000s. So this is the capabilities that we achieved. There's a huge amount of information technology behind it, as we understand, but it's not also only about technology. This is a key issue, is the strategy, doctrine, and organization has to be adapted. So I want to use this framework to analyze current situation. I will use the American example. It's nothing personal against my American friends and colleagues. It's just a convenient example. What we have is, as I described, the Americans described themselves, the cyber threat is correctly recognized. Even the Deputy Secretary of Defense, Lin, said, Secure military networks will matter little if the power grid goes down. We have all the indications that the energy R&D banks, all of them are being constantly attacked by, often by foreign attacks, by foreign actors. So the threat recognition is there. Capabilities-wise, we all know that the American capabilities are second to none. And the budgets are there, and so on. The intelligence community and Department of Defense invest many billions of dollars annually in R&D, procurement, and operations. They have in their own systems, they apparently hack others. Now, what is the federal response, federal approach to the critical infrastructure protection? What is the federal response, the state's response to foil corporate espionage? They are all recognized by as top threats, but neither of the response, there's a lot of responses going on, but neither of them are considered defense issues. There's a wide range of response, enhancing business investment in IT security, facilitating information sharing with Department of Homeland Defense, diplomacy, naming and shaming China, law enforcement, all are wonderful, but hardly what I would expect to see from the most powerful nations regarding to the most grave threat that it describes.
This building will be attacked 3 million times today. Who is going to protect it? Meet Staff Sergeant Lee Jones, Air Force Cyber Command, a member of America's only Cyber Command, protecting us from millions of cyber threats every day. It takes Air Force technology to defend America in a changing world. U.S. Air Force, above all.
So, this is one example. Who are they protecting? I see a very familiar pattern here. It is a pattern strikingly familiar to a security studies scholar, to a military innovation scholar. These revolutions take time, the adaptation takes time, and time is just one of resources. There are many others that have to be input into this equation. We can clarify this dissonance with using military innovation framework. I have brought several examples. I'm just going to use one. Strategic studies is a concept that is elusive enough. It talks about the nation's strategy as a result of its culture and its less tangible aspects. But it has been used spectacularly recently by our colleague Adamski, who described the adaptation of Israel, United States, and Russia to the information technology and security. So this is something that can be used. In this case specific of the American cyber defense, I would ask you to think about parameters that are not technology. We all, as I described, the threat awareness is there, capabilities are there, and the budget is there. From the politics perspective, strategic culture, as it expressed in the United States Constitution and in practice, United States Constitution is meant to limit the federal intervention with the private business. I think that it can be a good starting point to understand the track record of the civilian aspects of the American cyber defense and the fact that the Congress has struggled and failed to further any significant Department of Homeland Security capabilities to go beyond voluntary cooperation and promote the cybersecurity. So I trust no one wants to be on the receiving end of revolution in military affairs, and the successful revolution in military affairs were always not by the dominant power, but by someone else. I think that we need more conceptual tools. I think the security studies in general are essential, and specifically this military innovation analytical framework can be helpful. There is work to be done. Our discipline has neglected this field for a while. I hope I'm starting to repay the debt. So general lessons are there, and more specific lessons can be worked out using this new paradigm. I'm happy to provide more details. Yes, Maslow's hammer is there, but together we can overcome this limitation. Thank you very much.